The Battle of Borodino was a day of unparalleled carnage, the bloodiest single day's fighting of the entire Napoleonic era. Ostensibly, it was another victory for Napoleon, but today it is one of the most celebrated chapters in Russian military history. Borodino is the focus of Tolstoy's epic novel, War and Peace. Tchaikovsky's famous 1812 overture was written in tribute, and the battleground itself is a national museum. Borodino is the conclusive proof of the old military adage that you can win the battle but still lose the war. With the 1805 Treaty of Tilsit, which followed his brilliant victory at Austerlitz, Napoleon had placed strict economic controls against trade with Britain under the continental system.
The continental system goes like this. Nobody trades with Britain. That's the continental system. Nobody trades with Britain.
Having failed to defeat the Royal Navy, what Napoleon was going to do was actually destroy the British economy from within. After Tilsit in 1807, the Russians, of course, joined the continental system. And for a short time, it does seem that Europe is going to be united, or most of Europe will be united under Napoleon in this continental system. But very soon, the Russians discover that it's not altogether to their advantage.
Because the Russians were reliant upon Britain as a market for their hemp, for their flax, and in particular for wood, which the Royal Navy relied upon in order to build its ships. And without that export market, the Russians couldn't afford to import goods. And this obviously had a damaging effect upon their economy and alienated them progressively from the French.
Under pressure from the hard-pressed Russian merchants, the Tsar had begun to back out of this system. If Napoleon were ever to defeat the British, then the continental system must be enforced to the letter. The threat of war between France and Russia was escalated by a number of smaller tensions in the form of French intrigues with Turkey and Poland. The new Russian alliance with Sweden also heightened tensions. At this difficult juncture, the marriage of Napoleon to a Habsburg princess in preference to a Russian princess finally tipped the scales to all-out war. Napoleon had to force Tsar Alexander into a peace treaty and returned superiority to France.
Napoleon knows that he has a lot of enemies. He knew that if he didn't take good care to prepare in advance, the Russians would get the Austrians and the Prussians to join in against him. Napoleon went to the Prussians and said, "Prussians, if you don't get on side for my attack on Russia, I will occupy Berlin. And I will put my own king in there, and I'll ensure that you are on side." The Austrians, he goes to the Austrians and he says, "Austrians, I beat you a few years ago and I took away your Adriatic provinces. Well, I will give them back to you if you join me in my war against Russia. Oh, and by the way, I have an army of 200,000 men on your border and I'll invade you if you say no." So he has a little bit of the carrot, a little bit of the stick, and the Austrians see where the wind is blowing, and they come on side.
Napoleon's initial strategy in 1812 was simple. In his own words, it was to concentrate 400,000 men at a single point. It would be the largest armed force ever gathered together, the most ambitious operation devised in the annals of warfare. In total, some 800,000 men were actually mobilized. Napoleon hoped that the mere presence of this huge army would intimidate Russia into suing for peace without having to fight at all. Failing this, Plan B was to smash the Russian forces with a single battle close to the frontier, forcing peace and the renewal of French supremacy in Europe.
Napoleon wanted to kick the Russians into line. In order to do this, Napoleon wanted to go to Russia, not go far into Russia, just go to Russia, make the Russians come out to fight him, give the Russians a good kicking, and then the Russians fall into line. He doesn't want to invade Russia, he doesn't want to occupy Russia, he doesn't want to spend a lot of time in Russia, he just wants to give the Russian army a good kicking and have the Tsar fall into line.
We're talking about a united Europe marching into Russia. The largest non-French national components going along with Napoleon were the Prussians. They had around about 40,000 men. The Austrians with about 40,000.
The rest were an agglomeration of Poles, of which there were many, Italians, many other Germans, Spaniards, Portuguese, even a regiment of Egyptian Mamluk cavalry. So a rather diverse and polyglot formation, shall we say. In addition, it's worth bearing in mind that Napoleon's army was not made up of the best of the French forces. Many of the best French troops were actually in the Iberian Peninsula, where they'd been tied down really ever since 1808 by a prolonged war of attrition against the Spanish people, the Portuguese backed up by the British, so that there were relatively few veteran campaigners on the campaign of 1812.
Napoleon had been campaigning for years. He'd been using people up, and he was relying on looking to younger and younger conscripts with less and less training to fill out the army. So Napoleon's army was big. It was really, really big, but it wasn't cohesive, and it didn't have a lot of hardened veterans in it.
The first Russian armies to oppose the Grand Army were under the command of Barclay de Tolly, who was of Prussian extraction and was seen very much as one of the Russian Prussians, who were actually out of favour in the court at St. Petersburg at the time. And the other army was under the command of Prince Peter Bagration. And Bagration was ill-educated, ill-read. Barclay de Tolly is the intellectual soldier. He studied the works of von Bülow. He understands about lines of operation. Peter Bagration is the man of passion, the Georgian. He represents something of the spirit of Russia from the Caucasus.
Napoleon hoped to use his mammoth army in a series of lightning maneuvers. Napoleon felt he would be able to force a decisive battle early in the campaign. He was certainly not prepared for a winter campaign, and definitely not one which stretched all the way to Moscow.
It's very difficult to know whether Napoleon's campaign plan for 1812 was a good or a bad one, if only because we don't have any real documentary evidence that provides us with firm evidence of what he really intended to achieve. However, on the balance of probability, it appears that Napoleon did seek to engage and to destroy the bulk of the Russian field armies within about 200 to 300 miles of the frontier and within 2 to 3 weeks of campaigning. However, his problem was that the Russians decided that rather than fight a pitched battle in that area and in that time, they would withdraw towards the east, using the great space and the resources of Russia, time in particular, in order to generate the capability to fight Napoleon under terms of their choosing rather than his.
For every step back the Russians take, Napoleon takes a step further away from where he's strong. Every step Napoleon takes, his troops get hungrier, he's further from his supply nodes, he's further from France. Every step back the Russians take, they're winning.
Had Napoleon's grand strategy gone to plan, the likelihood was that the Russian armies would have been destroyed and the French objectives swiftly achieved. However, Napoleon's designs were thwarted by the very size of his armies and by the ineffectual leadership of his relations. Prince Jerome was an abysmal example of military leadership, and together with Eugene, he managed to translate what should have been a lightning maneuver into a torpidly slow plod.
What really made the campaign develop as it did was that Napoleon time and time again came close to engaging the Russians, On at least three separate occasions, Napoleon almost grasped at the Russian armies, only to find that he'd only caught their rear guard or that they managed to disengage during the night. And so he's continually reaching out for the Russians, trying to grasp them, sometimes grasping the rear guard and engaging that and thinking that's the real army, and then being drawn further and further by this failure. They just slip through his fingers time and time again.
At 44 years of age, Napoleon no longer possessed the energy of his earlier campaigns. Indeed, nearly 7 years before, at the Battle of Austerlitz, he had said, "We are granted only a limited time for making war. I give myself another 6 years, after which even I ought to stop." This was reflected in his actions at Vitebsk, where, by allowing his troops one day's rest, he missed a prime opportunity to engage his foe in an action and allowed them to slip away to Smolensk.
When Napoleon came to Borodino, he expected to have been burned out a year before. He knew how hard he worked. He knew how much he demanded of his body and of his mind, and he knew that he was burning out rapidly. And by the time he got to Borodino, Napoleon was a burnout case.
Mentally, he was showing signs of megalomania, even paranoia. He was also rather lethargic and hesitant, especially at decisive moments, not least at Borodino. Physically, of course, it's also worth bearing in mind that Napoleon was not a particularly well man in 1812. He had a rather nasty bladder infection, he had cystitis. In addition, he had colds during 1812, hardly surprising perhaps when you're operating in a place like Russia. But nonetheless, when these things combined, his sort of mental lethargy or lassitude and his sort of physical debilitation, the outcome could hardly be positive for the French cause.
Despite the tragedy that beset him, at Smolensk, Napoleon was finally able to bring the Russians to battle. At Smolensk, Napoleon threw his troops into a bloody frontal assault on the city. The Russians were able to mount a successful defense and then undertake a further retreat to safety. Napoleon had reached the critical point of his campaign. It was late August. His strategy of swift victory was in tatters, and winter was closing in. His army, originally totaling over 400,000 men, had diminished to a mere 185,000. Casualties from battle had reduced the numbers, but desertion, starvation, and sickness had also wreaked a terrible toll on this once Grande Armée. Napoleon's lines of supply and communication were hugely overstretched, and each of these miles required protection, and thereby the loss of yet more soldiers from the central force. Rotting corpses of both soldiers and horses lined the roads travelled by the French, and the results of Russian scorched earth tactics offered little succour.
The French logistics system depended to a very large extent on requisition. We would call it plunder. And in many areas of Europe, this had worked very well, in the Po Valley and the Rhine Valley, in those areas which were agriculturally very rich. But of course, the further east you got in Europe, the more sparse were the supplies. And so what the Russians did was to simply burn the crops, burn the fields, kill the animals or drive the animals off in front of the French army's advance. You burn your own country, you destroy the agricultural base of your own society, but at the same time, you increase the difficulties of Napoleon and his army immeasurably.
Napoleon was faced with two choices. He could either press on against a disorganized enemy and conquer Moscow, risking severe wintering in Russia in the hope that Alexander would be forced to his knees, or retreat with the whole knowledge that he had been defeated strategically. Napoleon also received news of the attempted coup of General Mallet in Paris, as well as of bread riots and even outbreaks of Luddism in France. Thus, on the horns of a particularly unpleasant dilemma, and with his recurring cystitis infection playing up, Napoleon chose to grab the bull by those same horns and to journey further into the Russian interior and force their hand. One factor which appeared to operate in Napoleon's favor were the tensions which were becoming apparent in the Russian forces. The Russian commander, Barclay de Tolly, was of Scots extraction, who came from the part of Russia which had a large German population, although he was entirely Russian. There was a growing feeling amongst the Russian nobility and the Russian population that the Tsar should be separated from the German officers who were advising him. Unfortunately, Barclay was Minister of War.
Barclay de Tolly is a man of mind, a man of intellect, and doesn't have that emotional appeal to the average Russian soldier.
He was of Scots extraction, he'd been born in Germany, and to many Russians, especially in 1812 when they were retreating, his retreating policy looked more like being a traitor than actually being a patriotic Russian.
The Tsar was now coming under pressure from the Russian nobility to appoint a full Russian general. He therefore looked to Kutuzov, who was the epitome of the Russian ideal. Mikhail Kutuzov was nearly 70 years old and the veteran of countless campaigns. He had been the Russian commander at Austerlitz, but was so overruled there by the impetuous Tsar that his reputation had survived intact. Of less importance than his appetite for champagne, rich food, ladies of easy virtue, and bad French literature was his reputation for fighting, the very opposite of the embarrassing retreat so far seen in the conflict. As well as a brilliant motivator, Kutuzov was also closely associated with the great General Suvorov and his beloved cult of the bayonet. In short, he had all the characteristics of a Russian national hero.
Kutuzov was coming out of retirement to lead the Russian army, and the Russian army was delighted. Because here was a great Russian, a real Russian, coming out of the pages of history to lead them on to victory. Kutuzov was a real Russian. He wasn't like Barclay, a Scottish surname and a German general. He wasn't like any of these guys with German surnames or Finnish surnames or Swedish surnames. He was a real Russian coming to lead the Russian army to victory. And that was just what the Russian army wanted to see.
Kutuzov is like an icon. He's the Russian version of Nelson. He's been wounded so many times. He's been shot through his head, and he survives. And the Russians actually see him almost as an embodiment of the spirit of Russia.
Kutuzov immediately decided to pitch a defensive battle in order to save Moscow. Public opinion and the Tsar demanded little else.
It's counterintuitive to suggest to an 18th or early 19th century Russian nobleman that allowing the French invader to tread on the holy soil of Mother Russia is the way to win. Chivalric ethics, chivalric zeal are saying to the Russians, you must fight, you must conduct a battle. Don't retreat, don't walk away, don't just let Napoleon defeat himself. You must go out and conduct a battle and use a lot of sabers and steel and artillery, bang, bang. That's what the Russians want to do so that they'll feel like they're attacking Napoleon. So the Russians abandon the wise policy of just letting Napoleon come, and they have to fight a battle.
It was Kutuzov's chief of staff, General Bennigsen, who actually surveyed the route from Moscow running forward in the general direction of Smolensk. And he saw near the village of Borodino an excellent choke point where there were no flanks, where streams and rivers actually constricted movement. And he advised Kutuzov that this would be the place to stand and fight.
In addition, it's worth remarking that Bagration's chief of staff actually knew the battlefield from his youth. So it was an area with which one of the commander's most important subordinates was actually personally familiar, although whether this was actually significant on the day is rather more open to question.
Touring the site on the 3rd of September, accompanied by a huge eagle wheeling above, Kutuzov chose to make a stand on the east bank of the Kolochka River, just to the south of Borodino. The battlefield lay in picturesque rolling countryside. It occupied an area roughly 2 miles square between both the Moscow-bound old and new Smolensk roads. The Kolochka River bisected the ground with the shallow, marshy Semenovka stream running off in a southward direction between the two halves of a low ridge. Borodino village itself lay on the new Smolensk road, over on the western bank of the Kolochka, and was a relatively weak defensive position. Presuming the French would advance on his right flank, Kutuzov immediately put his troops to work, fortifying the northern section of this low ridge. With a gentle glacis and commanding a field of fire both marvelous and deadly, this was to hold a battery of 18 cannon and became known as the famous Raevsky Redoubt. The southern ridge was also strengthened by the construction of three V-shaped Bagration fletches. To help strengthen the position, General Bennigsen ordered the construction of a defensible observation post, the Shevardino Redoubt. A short way back on the new Smolensk road, the main Russian artillery battery was placed by the village of Gorky. The First Army of the West was given responsibility for the Russian right flank, and General Barclay positioned his troops. The lifeguard Jaegers were in Borodino village, Bagovut, Tolstoy, and Dokhturov's 2nd, 4th, and 6th Corps held the line down to the Raevsky Redoubt. The redoubt itself was defended by a section of 7 Corps under General Raevsky, who were also stretched down as far as Semenovskaya village. The entire flank was supported by the mobile reserves of the 1st Cavalry Corps and Platov's much-feared Cossacks. A more sedentary reserve, consisting of 2nd and 3rd Cavalry Corps, was placed immediately behind the infantry. Bagration's 2nd Army then took responsibility for the left flank. The area of the Bagration fleches was seen by Lieutenant General Borodzin, who placed the 7th Combined Grenadier Division inside the defences, with the 27th Infantry Division of Neverovsky behind. Initially, both 5th and 3rd Corps were placed in the centre as a strong reserve for the left, along with the 26 batteries of the artillery reserve and the local militia, the Moscow Opolcheni. The latter, barely armed, untrained but eager civilians, were assigned the role of carrying off the wounded and intercepting any deserters. However, Kutuzov then realized that Napoleon was also perfectly able to advance on the southern old Smolensk road and was forced to deploy Tuchkov's 3rd Corps from the reserve, along with 1,500 Cossacks and 7,000 of the Opolcheni. Four further Jaeger regiments were sent to cover the area between Bagration and Tuchkov, whose force was cunningly concealed in a dense wood. Unfortunately, this giant ambush was foiled by the ever-helpful General Bennigsen, who, in order to allay Jaeger fears and without consulting Kutuzov, ordered 3rd Corps to reveal their whereabouts and close up behind them. Expecting an attack along the new Smolensk road and against the advice of Barclay, Kutuzov had built up an overly strong right wing and an extended, weaker left wing. He did, however, feel confident enough to inform the Tsar that the position I have taken up at Borodino is one of the best you could find. I am confident we shall win. Napoleon, riding out on the 5th of September to survey his opponents, was of an entirely different opinion.
The Russians assumed that Napoleon would be stupid. The Russians assumed that they could put General Barclay out there and that Napoleon would go for General Barclay the way a bull goes for a red cape in a bullfight, and that just when Napoleon was about to hit Barclay, then Bagration would come and hit him in the flank. The Russians did not take into account that Napoleon wasn't singing from their song sheet. Napoleon sees Barclay, Napoleon sees Bagration, and Napoleon says, I'm going right between the two. He's going to commit himself to a long, slow infantry assault across open ground. Napoleon figures he's going to lose 20,000 men doing it, but Napoleon figures he can afford to lose 20,000 men at the Battle of Borodino if it will get him a decisive defeat of the Russians. So Napoleon looks at the ground and says, we're going to go straight up the middle across an open field with no cover and let the might of French arms win.
Napoleon's plan for the Battle of Borodino is, I think, unimaginative and risk-averse, certainly. He could have done things that would have been bold, manoeuvrist, and would have avoided the rather bloody attritional battle that followed. But I think what dominates Napoleon's considerations at Borodino is the fear that once again the Russians are going to slip through his fingers, as they had done three times before during the campaign of 1812.
His initial move, in fact, came late in the afternoon of the 5th and saw the 35,000 troops of 1 and 5 Corps set out against the Shevardino Redoubt, an hors d'oeuvre before the real fight. General Command's 1 Corps was to move directly on the redoubt, and Poniatowski's Polish 5th Corps undertook a flanking manoeuvre around to the south. The roar of the artillery preceded the actual encounter, which took place as the sun faded over the horizon, darkness only adding to the confusion. As chance would have it, Neverovsky's 27th Division had drifted over to the redoubt during the day, boosting Russian numbers to 18,000, and once again they put up a truly dogged defense. A murderous musketry duel developed between the two forces, only brought to a close when Compans dragged up 4 cannon pieces, open fire at close range, shattering the ranks of the Russian infantry and bringing the redoubt under French control. Further troops were fed into what was fast becoming a general action involving the southern wings of both armies. The 2nd Grenadier Division recaptured the redoubt for the Tsar, and the 2nd Cuirassiers slaughtered an entire French infantry regiment. However, as midnight approached, it became clear that the Russian position was no longer tenable. Prince Poniatowski was making steady progress from the south, and the divisions of Friant and Morand were closing in from the west. The order to fall back to the regular line of the Second Army was given, and battle drew to a close. The French at last held strong over the redoubt. In total contrast to the heated act of September the 5th, barely a shot was heard on the 6th. Both sets of forces, it seemed, were preparing themselves for the storm ahead. Napoleon surveyed the Russian lines astride his horse, L'Embellie, and refined his strategy accordingly. He further concentrated his troops on the Russian left, placing 2/3 of his army there, totaling 85,000 men. Davout's 1st Corps, supported by Murat's cavalry, were to deliver the initial blow. 2nd and 8th Corps and the forces under Morin were placed above, up as far as the Kolochka. The Imperial Guard was held in reserve. North of the Kolochka, the responsibilities fell to Eugene's 4th Corps, who were to take the village of Borodino and then make the first assault upon the Raevsky Redoubt.
Raevsky's Redoubt enabled Bagration to put a large battery of guns right in the middle of his line, providing artillery cover to his infantry.
Now redoubts were usually built to allow the gunners to actually pull their guns out at the last minute. And Raevsky ordered that a real wall be constructed on the redoubt because he had no intention of abandoning this position at all. The Russians were there and they're going to stay there and they were going to die fighting by their guns. It was the linchpin of the entire Russian position at Borodino.
On the Russian side, the 6th saw Kutuzov untroubled by further doubts. His battle plan was set in stone. Instead, he organized the strengthening of the Raevsky Redoubt and then toured his army, giving speeches to individual regiments, exhorting them to defend our native soil and serve loyally and honorably to the last drop of your blood. Russian Orthodox clergy with holy banners had also traveled with the Russian soldiers, giving the army a sanctified aura as they blessed soldiers and regimental colors alike with holy water, raising religious fervor to fever pitch as they paraded the famous icon of the Black Virgin of Smolensk as night drew in before the real day of reckoning. The calm was broken at 6 a.m. on September the 7th when the French gunners thundered into action. Their Russian counterparts were not long to reply in kind, and battle once again commenced. Napoleon's leading divisions duly rolled into action, their drums beating the pas de charge. The first action came when Prince Eugene's 4th Corps stormed into Borodino village, catching the lifeguard Jaegers stationed there completely unawares and routing them in a few short minutes. As they scrambled across the bridge to safety on the east bank of the Kolochka, the French muskets took their terrible toll, and the regiment lost some 30 officers and over half its men. A disordered start for the Tsar. Meanwhile, 1st Corps had advanced on the Bagration Fletches, and Poniatowski's outflanking manoeuvre seemed to be going well, as he had already expelled the Russians from the village of Utitsa. The advance guard of 1 Corps, under General Compans, marched through the storm of fire and descended upon the Fletches. Casualties were already piling up, and Compans himself was carried from the battlefield after only 90 minutes, just as the southernmost Fletch fell to his men. General Ermolov commented that it was only the superiority of the bayonet in the hands of the Russian soldiers that enabled them to maintain this resistance for so long. Just when it seemed victory was a foregone conclusion, the tide of the battle changed. Poniatowski's advance was checked by Tuchkov's artillery batteries and the hail of musket fire from the Russian Jaegers. Barclay freed the 2nd Corps of General Bagovut from inactivity and sent them down to support Tuchkov on the left. As his soldiers streamed down the line, eager to get some action, Bagovut dropped off two regiments and various artillery pieces to his hard-pressed colleagues on the way. The French 1st Corps were now expelled from the Fletches following a ferocious counterattack by the 7th Combined Grenadier Division, supported by a mixture of dragoons, lancers, and hussars. Around this time, Prince Eugene also made the first assault on the Raevsky Redoubt and was repulsed with little difficulty.
The Raevsky Redoubt, the Grand Redoubt, had 20 guns and a whole lot of muskets in it. The muskets were there to defend the guns. And it meant that 20 reasonably large artillery pieces fired on the French as they tried to engage the Russian infantry. It meant that the Russian guns were not encumbered by being behind the Russian infantry. They were right up in front. There was nothing at all to come between the Russian guns in the redoubt and the attacking Frenchmen. No cover for the attacking Frenchmen.
The Revsky Redoubt came to represent one of the focal points of the Battle of Borodino. It had the effect of sucking men and materiel into the centre of the battlefield, away from the flanks, which remained, by Borodino's standards at least, relatively quiet throughout the day. So what you've got is this maelstrom in the centre of the Russian line, with attack after attack coming from French infantry and then later from French cavalry, surging up the slope, being blasted to pieces. Indeed, for one part of the battle, the French actually found that they had to, because they'd run out of infantry essentially in this area, keep thousands of horsemen, of cavalry, standing directly in front of the Revsky Redoubt in order to hold a gap in the centre of their own line. And for about 3 hours, these French cavalry simply sat there, being smashed to pieces by the artillery in the Revsky Redoubt and the artillery pieces that supported it, at enormous cost, obviously, both in men and horses. Thousands of men and thousands of horses fell without a single attack actually being launched during this period.
As a decision loomed, the battle increased in intensity, particularly for the Bagration Fletches. Napoleon sent in the cavalry of Montbrun for support, and before long, Junot's 7th Corps were to join them. Part of the Young Guard was also sent to stabilize the Polish positions at Utitsa. So Napoleon had already committed the majority of his reserves well before midday. General Rapp, a French aide-de-camp, also received his 22nd battle wound at this time. 10 o'clock came, and the French drew their forces together for a tremendous push against the Russian left center. 3 infantry corps, supported by 2 cavalry corps, and the massed fire of 250 artillery pieces were to make a determined assault upon the area surrounding the Fletches. The French guns created havoc amongst the Russians, but paled when compared to the carnage wreaked by Bagration's 300 guns on the French troops as they rushed up the slope towards the fortifications. Marshal Ney alone was wounded 4 times in this episode, but of great significance to the Russians was that General Bagration had to be carried from the field wounded. This event so demoralized the men of Generals Borodzin and Bagovut that they temporarily gave up their positions. Sensing victory was in their grasp, the French cavalry swept in under the flamboyant command of Joachim Murat, the King of Naples, hoping to develop a Russian retreat into a rout. Murat cut a remarkable figure, bedecked in oversized riding boots and great golden spurs, a fantastically embroidered light blue jacket, dark ringlets flowing under a fancy Jacobean hat, and topped with a long white feather. More importantly, he was also a great horseman and soldier. Drawing back in fine order, however, the Russians countered this new threat by forming orderly squares, which repeated cavalry charges had little prospect of disrupting. At this stage, a stalemate seemed to be developing, and the French commanders made repeated requests that Napoleon should send in the Old Guard to finish off the Russians for good. The French Emperor, seemingly apathetic and devoid of his usual mental energy, refused. He would need to leave this hostile land sooner or later, and they were his only wholly intact force, his devoted corps d'élite at that. To throw them into battle would severely compromise his chances of a successful retreat.
Throwing the Imperial Guard into the battle might have made a real difference. If he'd put it into the battle early in the day, in particular when there was a moment to do so, the Russians might very well have been smashed on the battlefield.
Napoleon has a strategic reserve, a strong strategic reserve. The question is, should he have used it for the tactical purpose of affecting the course of the Battle of Borodino? The answer for Napoleon is no. If I use up the guard today at Borodino, I won't have them tomorrow when I need them again.
While the guard exists, Napoleon exists. And if he makes a mistake, if he attacks with that guard and the guard is destroyed, then so too is Napoleon. It's precisely what happens at Waterloo. His guard is destroyed. Now, Napoleon is a long, long way from home. He's in the middle of a hostile country. What is he to do? Is he to commit the guard and run the risk of losing everything? And he hesitates.
The stalemate caused by Napoleon's refusal to commit the guard gave both commanders a chance to lick their wounds. Kutuzov used the approach to reinforce his weakened center with Tolstoy's 4th Corps and sending Uvarov's cavalry forces on a diversion into the village of Borodino. Uvarov temporarily routed General Delzon's cavalry, and in doing so, caused another appeal to Napoleon for reinforcements, just as he was about to order a fresh attack. This not only gave the Russians more breathing space, as it took the French more than an hour to recover their composure after this irritation, it also cemented Napoleon's decision to reserve the Imperial Guard for later action. 2 p.m. approached, and the Grande Armée diligently readied itself for a further sledgehammer blow on the Russian center, and the Raevsky Redoubt in particular. 3 of Prince Eugene's infantry divisions were to provide the frontal assault, with a concentration of 400 artillery pieces providing a devastating bombardment as cover. Unable to locate his cuirassier reserves, Barclay could not strengthen his forces within and around the redoubt. They would be without cavalry support for the time being, at least.
And the only way for the French to be able to attack the Russians without being massacred by the guns of Raevsky's redoubt was to go into the redoubt and kill everybody inside. So Prince Eugene, the French cavalry commander, is given the task of attacking the redoubt, and the only side where there are not a lot of muskets, a lot of guns pointing at you, is the back. And Prince Eugene goes round the back of the redoubt, comes in from the direction where the guns are not pointing, and he kills all the gunners.
Eugene's infantry soon arrived to consolidate the success and were met by a scene of untrammeled horror. The dead and mutilated, both men and horses, lay 6 or 8 deep within and completely filled the ditches and entrances. The redoubt was firmly in French control, and a sizable breach had therefore been opened in the Russian lines. Was this to be the decisive event Napoleon so needed? Just as Eugene was about to throw all the available French cavalry into the fray and exploit the opportunity, the Russian General Barclay somehow managed to muster 2 cavalry corps and foil his opponent. The Russian infantry formed squares once more, and one of the most stubborn cavalry battles of history duly began. It was only thanks to the superior strength of the Russian horses that the defense was a success, and the infantry were able to withdraw safely to a new line. By now, both sides were battle-weary, and the tempo of battle slowed. This most malevolent of days still had more surprises to spring. Aware of ebbing French energy, Kutuzov ordered the forces of 5 Corps to mount a counter-offensive. The ever-vigilant French 1st Corps became alert to this and was able to stop the Russians with the assistance of a further 80 guns from the artillery reserve. Meanwhile, Prince Poniatowski, still skirmishing against the Russian left flank, had received news that the redoubt had been taken and was roused to launch one further assault on the Russians at Utitsa, who were by now in a dangerously exposed salient. He made good progress against the remaining Russian forces, and by 5 p.m. they had withdrawn, falling back to the line now taken by the rest of the Russian army. The fighting finished almost by mutual consent of the exhausted soldiers, and, able to fight no longer, the Russians retreated to safety, their numbers depleted but essentially intact.
I think that the Russians at Borodino did extremely well to survive that battle, and to be able to withdraw a large part of their army intact was a genuine achievement. The Russian army at Borodino was smaller than the French army, so under these circumstances, and not least because the initial Russian deployment was a rather bad one, with the main weight of its forces on the right wing rather than on the left where the French actually attacked, that the Russians were able to survive this battle is a testimony both to the capabilities of their commanders, in particular Barclay de Tolly, but even more so perhaps the moral resilience of the ordinary Russian peasant soldier. These were not useless Untermenschen, as Hitler might have characterised them a century and a bit later. These were capable, determined, resolute troops, as good, I would say, man for man, as any of the Frenchmen opposite them.
In achieving the victory at Borodino, the French alone had fired over 90,000 rounds of artillery, and the infantry had spent an estimated 2 million cartridges. The Russians suffered an incredible 44,000 casualties to the French 30,000, numbers which were not experienced on such a scale again until the horrors of Flanders during the First World War. More than 50 generals were lost by the two forces, and the Surgeon-in-Chief of the Imperial Guards had personally carried out over 200 amputations. It has been calculated that over 30% of all combatants received a wound of some form.
I think you can explain the appalling casualties for both sides at Borodino in 2 different ways. One is by reference to the mechanics of the battle, if you like, the formations which were used, the weapons which were used, the battle plans, if you like, all the things that actually happened on the day. But I think there's a much more important and broader explanation for the casualties, which is that both sides were willing to sustain such casualties. Armies like this do not stand for an entire day and slug it out at the cost that they did sustain on the 7th of September unless they are fighting with enormous passion, belief, even hatred. By the end of the Battle of Borodino, Karl von Clausewitz, great Prussian philosopher of war as he was to become, actually remarked that less than 1/3 of the soldiers who had started on that battlefield at the beginning of the day were still standing there. So what you're looking at is two armies standing face to face and beating each other to a pulp.
Despite a gain of a half mile, a slight tipping of the scales in Napoleon's favour, and the opening of the road to Moscow, this was at the very best a Pyrrhic victory.
The only way Napoleon can get what he came for, the only way he can get the Tsar to give in, to participate in the continental system, to stop trading with Britain, is to force the Tsar by going to Moscow, knocking on the Tsar's door and saying, give in. So Napoleon picks up his exhausted, bedraggled army. He picks up his own exhausted, pained carcass, and he heads for Moscow.
As is notorious, within a few days of arriving, fires begin in the city, and soon they consume up to 60% of Moscow. So there is Napoleon in the burning spiritual capital of the Russian Empire, his lines of communication stretching back to Poland and to Prussia, with intact Russian armies hovering on his flanks, his own strength diminishing by the day.
Effectively, what's happened is that the Russians have proved, both to themselves and to the French, that they can stand up against the French in battle for a full day and not be decisively defeated. And to be able to do that, in particular given the disaster of Austerlitz back in 1806 when a Russian army had been destroyed, was important to the Russian people's self-respect, and said to the French, we can fight you, we can stop you, you will not defeat us. It was a statement of intent, it was a statement of moral capability.
Furthermore, reinforcements were being raised across the country. And much buoyed by Borodino, the Tsar stood firmer than ever against any sort of peace.
At the end of the day, Napoleon may have won the Battle of Borodino in some technical sense. What did it get him? Nothing. Napoleon assembles a huge army, the Grande Armée. He's got 500,000 people in this army. He's got another 175,000 people watching his flanks. He's united all of Europe, all of continental Europe in this effort. He has gone to Borodino. He has won his battle as far as he's concerned. He carries on to Moscow, and what does he get? Nothing.
Indeed, some historians have argued that if the Battle of Borodino had been lost by the French, as long as they hadn't been annihilated in the process, they would have been better off, because they would have been forced to retreat back to Smolensk, which was their base of supply. And from Smolensk, they could have either tried again the following year, or they certainly would have found themselves much closer to Poland and a degree of relative safety. Whereas by being drawn further into Russia, into Moscow, and then forced to retreat all the way back to Poland during the depths of a Russian winter, essentially they consigned themselves to disaster.
This was a Pyrrhic victory with a capital P.